far we have seen algorithms where you have of the order of n cube or n square as the number of computations or the computational cost, but can we bring it down to of the order of n? And that is one of the very important and interesting questions that one would like to answer, because if that is possible, that can reduce the number of computations to a significant extent. And that is indeed possible, not for all types of matrices, but for matrices which are tridiagonal in nature, and the corresponding algorithm is known as tridiagonal matrix algorithm or TDMA. It is also known as Thomas algorithm. Let us first try to understand that what is the motivation. In CFD, this is a very important algorithm. And why it is so? Because in CFD, it is not very uncommon to get a tridiagonal matrix as a coefficient matrix. Why? Let us consider a one dimensional problem. Let us say that you have a grid point P, you have its neighboring grid points E and W. So, you have AP phi P is equal to AE phi E plus AW phi W plus B. In general, it is a summation of the coefficients from its neighboring grid points and of course the source term. You can write it in terms of indices. If you assign indices, you can write, if you call P as I, E as I plus 1 and W as I minus 1, you can write AI phi I is equal to bi phi I plus 1 plus ci phi I minus 1 plus di of this form, where I is P, I plus 1 is E, I minus 1 is W. And this is logically obvious because in our discretization we make sure that events at a grid point are influenced only by its immediate neighbors. Other neighbors do not come into the picture. If you use higher order interpolation techniques, then only other neighbors will come into the picture. But because of the linear profile assumption, only the immediate neighbor will come into the picture. So you will have for a one dimensional problem only two neighbors plus the grid point itself makes three grid points involved at each time. So, if you write it in a matrix form, so something into phi 1 is equal to something into phi 2, there is no phi 0. Let us say your grid point starts with 1, then 2, then 3, then 4 in this way up to n. So this is your domain. So phi 1 has phi 2, there is no phi 0, nothing called phi 0. So phi 1 and phi 2 are the two non-zero coefficients for the first equation, and there is something in the right hand side. For the second equation, something into phi 2 is equal to something into phi 3 plus something into phi 1 plus something. So the second equation involves non-zero coefficients as phi 1, phi 2 and phi 3. So phi 1, phi 2, phi 3 and something in the right hand side. third equation will involve phi 2, phi 3, phi 4. So, phi 2, phi 3, phi 4. In this way, you will see that if you have considered all the equations, what are the non-zero terms which are involved? One is this diagonal term, this corresponding to phi 1, this corresponding to phi 2, this corresponding to phi 3, like that. Then the two immediate off diagonal terms, and all others are 0. Such a matrix, such a coefficient matrix is called as a tri-diagonal matrix, where you have the main diagonal and the two immediate off diagonals. So, any algorithm corresponding to the solution of such a system is known as a tri-diagonal matrix algorithm. So, the first thing that we have understood is why the importance of tri-diagonal matrix is there for a discretized system of equations in one dimensional problem. Next is how it is possible that you could come down to a computational complexity of the order of n. It is possible by considering that any matrix for its storage requirement, it requires two indices I and j. Here, what we will do is instead of using two indices I and j, we will just use one index for storing the entries corresponding to all these three diagonals together. And that is how we will have a linear storage system instead of having a two dimensional array for storing the system. And that is the basic origin behind improving the computational performance of this algorithm. So, let us try to figure out that how we can do that. So, let us take a prototype equation of this particular form. Ai phi I is equal to bi phi I plus 1 plus ci phi I minus 1 plus di. Say this is the equation that you have obtained out of one dimensional discretization problem. Now, if you can start from the left hand side to the right hand side. So, your first equation will be a 1 phi 1 is equal to b 1 phi 2 plus d 1, c 1 will be 0 because there is no phi 0. So, you can write phi 1 is equal to b 1 phi 2 plus d 1 by a 1. That means phi 1 is a function of linear function of phi 2. Second equation a 2 phi 2 is equal to b 2 phi 3 plus c 2 phi 1 plus d 2. In place of phi 1, you can substitute as function of phi 2. So, this will give you phi 2 as a function of phi 3, linear function again. In this way, you can use the previous step to write phi 3 as a function of phi 4, phi 4 as a function of phi 5. In this way, phi n will be a function of phi n plus 1, but there is nothing called phi n plus 1. So, it is just a constant because there is nothing called n plus 1, n is the last grid point. So, now what we have to do is we have to systematize this approach. So, as if you know phi 1, you can know phi 2 from that, if you know phi 2, you can know phi 3 from that. It is not known explicitly, but implicitly. If phi 1 was known, then phi 2 would have been known. If phi 2 would have been known, phi 3 would have been known. In this way, if phi n would have been known, then phi n plus 1 would have been known in this way. But there is nothing called phi n plus 1. So, that means in this way, when you go to the last step, phi n is known. So, what we will do, we will consider that you have intermediate steps of this form. Phi I as P I phi I minus 1 plus Q I. This is the form that we look for. See, phi 2 as a function of phi 3, sorry, phi I plus 1. So, phi 2 as a function of phi 3, phi 3 as a function of phi 4 and linear function. So, linear function means of the form y equal to mx plus c of that form. So, y is a linear function of x, phi I is a linear function of phi I plus 1. Okay. So, this is the form of the linear function where I depends linearly on I plus 1, where this P I and Q I are not yet known to us. What is the immediate preceding step or immediate step before? Phi I minus 1 is equal to P I minus 1 phi I plus Q I minus 1. That is, replace I with I minus 1. Now, let us substitute this particular recurrence formula in the discretized equation. So, substitute in star. Say this is double star, substitute double star in star. So, A I phi I is equal to B I phi I plus 1 plus C I in place of phi I minus 1, we will write P I minus 1 phi I plus Q I minus 1. So, from here we get A I minus C I P I minus 1 phi I is equal to B I phi I plus 1 plus D I. So, phi I is equal to B I by A I C I A I minus C I P I minus 1 into phi I plus 1 plus D I there is 1 C I into Q I minus 1 plus D I, right. So, D I plus C I Q I minus 1 by A I minus C I P I minus 1. Now, you can see that this particular equation and the equation phi I is equal to P I phi I plus 1 plus Q I, these are of the same form. So, let us call it triple star, let us give it 4 star. So, compare this triple star and 4 star. So, what you get? P I is equal to B I by A I minus C I P I minus 1 and Q I is equal to D I plus C I Q I minus 1 by A I minus C I P I minus 1. where you have to keep in mind that C 1 is equal to 0. Why? Because there is no phi 0, and B n is equal to 0 because there is no phi n plus 1. And C 1 equal to 0 implies P 1 is B 1 by A 1 and Q 1 is D 1 by A 1. And what is phi n? Phi n is P n phi n plus 1 plus Q n. There is no phi n plus 1. So, phi n is Q n. So, the first value of phi that you can solve for is Q n. So, you start with I equal to 1, then you go to I equal to 2, 3, 4, 5 like that. When you get I equal to n, you have obtained P n and Q n. And phi n is q n. So, that is your forward elimination part. Let us systematize that. Before systematizing that, we can easily recognize that once you get phi n, then you can get phi n minus 1, because what is the formula that you are having? Phi I is equal to P I phi I plus 1 plus Q I. So, if you know phi n, then you can calculate phi n minus 1. If you know phi n minus 1, you can calculate phi n minus 2. So, that is your backward substitution. In this way, the first value of phi you calculate is phi n, then phi n minus 1, then phi n minus 2, phi n minus 3. In this way, you end up with phi 1. So, that is how you solve for the unknowns from phi 1 to phi n. So, here also it is logically like divided into two parts, forward elimination, where forward elimination is this part, and the remaining is backward substitution, where it is a straightforward use of this formula. So, based on this, let us now summarize the TDMA. So, first is you input AI, BI, CI, DI, that comes from your discretized equation. Then you have P 1 is equal to B 1 by A 1. Q 1 is D 1 by A 1. Remember, the equation that you are looking for is A I phi I is equal to B I phi I plus 1 plus C I phi I minus 1 plus D I. Then for I equal to 2 to n, you can calculate P I. This is a recurrence relationship. So, if you know P 1, you can calculate P 2 and Q 2. If you know P 1 and Q 1, if you know P 2 and Q 2, you can calculate P 3 and Q 3, and so on. Then phi n is equal to q n. Then you have a for loop in which you put the formula for phi I is equal to p I phi I plus 1 plus q I. So, for I equal to n minus 1, it will start with phi n minus 1, phi n is already known, it will end up to 1 with I minus minus, that is you have an increment of minus 1, that is each I will be 1 less than the previous I. So, this is the forward elimination part. This is the backward substitution part. And you can see that the forward elimination part is having a complexity of the order of n, because there is only one for loop there which runs up to the order of n. So, the TDMA has an algorithm complexity of the order of n, not n square or n cube. That is a big advantage. Now, as for any other method, we would also like to know whether the TDMA will work for all cases or not. And to do that, we will consider, or to assess that, we will consider a very simple problem. So, let us say that we have a rod, one dimensional system, where you have the heat flux at the left wall as given, say Q1, heat flux at the right boundary is also given, same as Q1. The length of this one is L, thermal conductivity is given. We will assume easy numerical values so that we can evaluate that easily. So, the objective is to find out temperature distribution, steady state temperature distribution in the rod. The steps will be finite volume discretization and solution of equation by TDMA. Let us consider that we have 3 grid points. You can also consider to be it to be equivalent finite difference discretization also, if you want finite volume or finite difference, whatever you want. Our focus here is not the discretization, but the solution. Let us take the second grid point at halfway. So, this is L/2 and this is L/2. Let us form the discretization equation corresponding to the grid point 2. So, what is the governing equation? ddx of k dt dx equal to 0. If k is a constant, it is as good as d2t dx2 equal to 0. So, if you consider a finite difference discretization, it is t3 plus t1 minus 2t2 by L by 2 square, that is equal to 0. Here delta x is L by 2. This is applied to grid point 2. That means T2 is T1 plus T3 by 2. For the boundary condition at 1, Q is equal to minus k dt dx at 1. So, k into t1 minus t2 by L by 2. So, t1 is equal to t2 plus q L by 2 k. Okay. Let us consider this q L by 2 k as a number a for simplicity. So, t 1 is equal to t 2 plus a. Then boundary condition at 3, in a very similar way, T3 is equal to T2 minus A. It is physically obvious because heat is being transferred from higher temperature to lower temperature. So, T3 will be less than T2. So, now let us try to arrange these equations in this particular form A I phi I. So, A 1 T 1 is equal to B 1 T 2 plus D 1. What is A 1? A 1 is 1, B 1 is 1 and D 1 is, in place of A let us give it a different name because A is already there, say alpha. So, this is equal to alpha, D 1 is alpha. Then what is A 2? A 2 T 2 is equal to B 2 T 3 plus C 2 T 1 plus D 2. So, what is A 2? A 2 is, you can write 2 T 2 and these as 1 and 1 in whatever way. So, this equation you can write as 2 T 2 equal to T 1 plus T 3 also. So, A 2 equal to 2, B 2 equal to 1, C 2 equal to 1, D 2 equal to 0. Then for the third point, A 3 T 3 is equal to C 3 T 1 plus D 3. What is A 3? 1, C 3, 1 D 3 minus alpha. Okay. So, these are our three equations. C 3 C3T, okay, that is T2, right. Okay, now you can go through the TDMA as it is there here. P1 is B1 by A1. So, P1 is B1 by A1, that is equal to 1. Q1 is D1 by A1, that is equal to alpha. Then P2 is B2 by A2 minus C2 P1. So, B2 is 1 by A2, 2 minus C2 P1. 1. Q2 is equal to D2 plus C2 Q1 by A2 minus C2 P1. So, what is D2? D2 is 0, C2 is 1, Q1 is alpha. So, alpha by A2, 2 minus C2 1 into P1 1. So, alpha. Then P3, B3 by A3 minus C3 P2. B3 is 0 divided by, let us see what it is there. A3 1 minus C3, C3 is 1 into P2 1. So, it is 0 by 0 form, indeterminate. So, you can see that the calculation of TDMA breaks down here. So, TDMA does not work for this case. Why it does not work for this case? If you consider the coefficient matrix, you will find what is the characteristic of the coefficient matrix here. Determinant of the coefficient matrix is 0, that you can easily verify. So, it is a singular coefficient matrix. So, remember that in whatever may be the method that we are using for solution, in Ax equal to b, x equal to A inverse b, inverse of a matrix is just like a sort of division. It is a systematic division considering a collection of numbers instead of a single number. So, if the inverse of A is what? Adjoint A by determinant A. So, if the determinant A is 0, if it is singular, then you can see A inverse as a problem. Physically, why the TDMA does not work here? I am giving this problem as an example because we have referred to this example earlier. You have this as actually an ill posed boundary value problem because you are having two flux boundary conditions where the fluxes are equal, and of course they should be equal because of one dimensional steady state heat conduction requirement, but that is already inbuilt with the governing equation. It is no new information. So, although you have specified fluxes at the two boundaries and they are equal, so it is physically consistent, but it is not giving you any additional information corresponding to the boundary condition. So, that gives rise to the singularity of a system. So, you can see an ill-posed boundary value problem, if nowhere detected otherwise, will face trouble when you are coming to solve the system of corresponding discretized algebraic equations. So, if the physics is somewhere erroneous in terms of describing the problem, somewhere mathematics will catch it. That is the beauty of mathematics, that if you are unable to represent the right physics through your mathematics, somewhere mathematics itself will interfere and detect itself that there is something wrong with the physics. So, TDMA may not work always. So, we will stop here today. In the next class, what we will do is, till now we have looked into the implementation of different elimination methods. In the next class, we will do an error analysis and we will try to figure out that what are the corresponding errors possible to be incurred and how we can quantify that in the elimination methods. Thank you.